arrow setup on any lane, so it's like kind of risky to do. Probably gonna end up in the middle. Like, maybe even a puck for S4.
That's
like,
what I was just gonna say. I mean, is puck out of the question? I know you're kind of putting everything on the drow, but what their lineup says so far is that's what they're alluding to. They might put everything on
the drow. I would really like puck, but as you said, the Dragon Knight would be really, really nice. Yeah, I think.
Even Medusa would be fine. They need like a tanky hero right now, like a tank up front. Medusa would be extremely good versus the Sven.
Yeah.
You have the draw aura and you know, you have that pushing power with your team.
If it just has no damage, if they pick another tanky push here, it's actually gonna be incredibly hard for Fnatic to deal with the push.
I mean, they're gonna rely on their lane dominance with the bounty. Like, if the bounty doesn't get a lot of work done for his team early, Fnatic is gonna struggle to defend their towers.
They don't really have good supports against Bounty though right now. I don't feel like anything in particular on the side of Alliance is really gonna punish anything that Bounty does.
Yeah, that's why I kind of prefer, like, if Mirana's ran as a core and you pick a better support.
Yeah. Like the problem that Bounty Hunter also has is he can't really efficiently gank any lane right now. Like the Dazzle is gonna keep it safe and secure. Tide Hunter is really hard to kill with the Bounty Hunter. And mid lane, if it's actually really the Mirana, yeah, sure, you can harass a bit, but you definitely won't find any kill there.
I mean, most of the Bounty's early game could actually just be keeping Tide down more than anything else. Oh. Just follow him around and stacks and things like that, because Bulldog is that guy who always stacks the Ancients in the large camp, like a ton. That might be what his best choice is here in this situation. Well, Fnatic do anticipate it is going to be a core Mirana as they banned out the Rubick. Alliance's right, last ban. Rid of the Jug.
Let me ask you guys a question. Do you like Abaddon here and just run Mirana as a core? Because Abaddon would be good against Bounty and Slaughter. They just have 5 men. I mean, they don't have much setup for Arrow, but just whatever. They're going to run down their
EGM enemies. Has played it in the past. Could be an option for them.
That seems pretty good against the Bounty and the Slaughter.
So support Abaddon is like actually really, really good here. If they want to run that, they will just 5-man power.
Would you do dual lanes with Tide with Abaddon?
I mean, like Tide Abaddon is like best lane. It can like
Fnatic can't do anything against that right now. Like, what is their safe lane going to be? Shadow Demon Sven, pretty much?
Yeah, exactly. Like the lane is not very strong, like Tide Hunter Abaddon, but their lane is like, what? Disruption into Sven's lane?
Yeah.
Nothing.
Yeah, not great.
No damage at all.
10 seconds remaining.
10 seconds to go. We'll have our answer soon. It's
Elder Titan.
Elder Titan. Wow. A fifth pick, Elder Titan.
It's still Elder Titan.
I did not actually.
Good job, guys. Good job.
How did Elder Titan get last picked?
I don't know. But now we have our answer. Mid bottom carry draw.
Yeah, that's the setup for the arrow. At least they have a setup right now, so you can actually get kills with the arrow into Starstorm. Yeah.
Natural order combats Sven's natural ability to bump up the armor a bit.
Remaining.
Solid pick.
And of course, like Elder Titan together with the Mirana Aghanims is like incredible. Reserve the natural time. Order, you just like destroy a hero instantly.
Fnatic needs like deep push right now. Yeah. There's not many good options available. I would still lean with the Quaswax Invoker, the Tide, Elder Titan, and the push.
They need deep push, but at the same time, they need strong like a deep push here that also deals a lot of burst damage. It's just gonna break their neck. Like, how do you 5-man with a like, Storm Spirit?
I don't think they can though, so I'm going for Alliance this game, despite Fnatic being my friends, but Alliance have a much easier game.
I think we're unanimous here.
Unanimous that Alliance and their Bull Rush is going to be enough to run over Fnatic. We'll have to see if that's going to be the case or not. We'll throw it over to our casters now for game number one of Day 3 action. It's Tobiwan and Merlini.
Thanks a lot, Dakota. Yes, it is time. Alliance TI winners before, but does that really count for that much? Fnatic going up against them, it's a whole new TI. Anyone could be a winner here, Melini.
Oh, you're blessed to be here, Drow Ranger, yet again.
Yeah, and
he's gonna win.
It's my dream as well. It's a big team fight. You bring in a Rabbit, you bring in the jump of a Storm Spirit, a fifth pick Elder Titan as well. The panel forgot about him. It looks like Alliance didn't.
I thought that Fnatic were.
Rags is going to pick it up once they, but with their drow strategy EVOM yesterday, I'm sure they analyzed that to death.
And we will find out. We will find out. We're going to go straight to our game and begin game number one of this full best of three. Alliance and Fnatic, one of these teams today, will not progress. We are over for them. We've already eliminated enough teams from TI6. Another one will drop today as Alliance. Okay, how do you actually feel about this laning phase? I know the panel was talking about having Abaddon teaming up with a Tidehunter for that offlane. How's the ET meant to slip in now? Is he a roaming support to help out mid and bottom? Or should he actually go and join Admiral Bulldog on top?
I think they realize that Fnatic's safe lanes are really weak. They don't have to do a lane up there. They don't need the Dazzle up there. They don't need the ABBA. And this way they can put EGM on a roamer. I think that's where you're really scared of Fnatic. Like, if you lose a lane and then Alliance start grouping up, taking your T1, there's very little room for comeback with the lineup that they have.
So no danger zone for them, pretty much what you're saying right now.
Yeah, they need to make sure they win the lanes really hard, try and get level 6 ASAP on Bounty Hunter and Sardar, make sure the storm's good. I do favor Alliance's draft here. It's much easier to execute and doesn't really require that much to outplay Fnatic in the teamfight. They have the Tidehunter Ravage, and Fnatic, what do they have in the way of teamfight? Maybe a little bit from Shadow Demon, maybe a little bit of Cleave from Sven, but those are all very minor AoE spells relative to Alliance's.
They've at least got the option to jump on the Drow Ranger on the back line. That's the advantage of Storm Spirit. He can go wherever the hell he wants. 3-4-3 as well, potentially can jump around the back lines with track vision. Fnatic could just make better decisions during the team fight. But you are right, Alliance is pretty much a stand, seal, and deliver against Fnatic, and Fnatic will have to play very, very good Dota in order to stay on top of Alliance.
They need the Storm to get a lot of farm. If the Storm gets Orchid early, like Bloodstone Orchid, then they can actually deal with the Dazzle. But right now, if they jump to Drow Ranger, Dazzle's just going to be there in the back. Elder Titans can stomp too. You don't even need a Ravage to save the Drow Ranger. But once the Orchid comes out, then they can actually just punish the Dazzle really quickly.
There's a big advantage for mid one, the fact that East shouldn't die to S4. There's no rotating supports that are really going to be a nuisance, unlike S4, who has to deal with 3-4-3. Early Orb of Venom forces a leap out of S4,
you know,
so he'll have to go back.
We always say shouldn't, but remember yesterday with the Ember and Huskar?
Yeah, there's a lot of coulda, shoulda, would. Nohaya gets harassed a little bit on bottom lane. 3-4-3 is still hovering around that mid, trying to keep S4 back away from the CS. And looks like finally EGM, yeah, it was only a matter of time before he would come.
Bulldog has 5 stacks on him. That one's killed him.
Very careful of DJ. DJ also takes a lot of damage to do that. EGM comes to the middle lane. They planned down a Sentry Wars, now they at least have Vision, the Bounty Hunter. It's kind of surprising because EGM also arrived with early dust on that Elder Titan. But they really want to try and find the kill. Ohio, that's a little off. Try to crush on Loader. Gotta be really careful when he does that too, because he has Sprint turned on. A little bit of extra damage.
Taunts on a curse, Toby. It's all Admiral Bulldog on the tail end of the backstroke.
Admiral Bulldog is just gonna try and bait them in. You think you got him, and then all of a sudden it's a turnaround. Ohio actually playing some more classic Jimmy spots, as he'll have to sprint level 1 sprint himself away. There's still no good control coming out from Alliance. Until Lotus got Gust or Cold Arrows, Ohio's gonna be free to do what he wants. Especially with EGM, like EGM went for Echo Stomp early on, but without the Spirit, the Slaughter should always be able to get away. Love
me. Slow laning phase, I think, is better off for Alliance. Just let need to get as many levels as they can on the Drow.
Kind of what we expected at the start. Very, very passive laning. No one wants to go anywhere too hard. 3-4-3 being kept down the levels until he leeches it from the lanes he goes to.
They're having a lot of trouble pulling on bottom though. They have that large camp blocked out by the Sentry Ward, and then you have the additional illusions help control the wave. And Loda's only like level 2 right now, which is not really where you want to be on the Drow Ranger.
3-4-3. Managed to get vision superiority again in mid lane. Able to get rid of that Radiant Sentry Ward so he can attack into S4. But at the same time that happens, EGM moves over to the mid lane. So making sure that Mirana is still able to find some level of high CS.
Bottles on the way, but no additional sentries for S4. If you're a Bounty Hunter right now, what's your mentality? Which lane are you going to go to? Which one looks most vulnerable to you? High Hunter, pretty difficult, especially if he has 6 charges. He has 0 at the moment. Mid lane, he has Leap. Maybe once Storm gets 6 or Storm gets a kill rune. Bottom lane, also not that easy, but it might be your best choice if you see one of the supports like out pretty far pulling. 3-4-3 going in, but
that's a flying courier with movement speed boost. That's not going to go anywhere apart from mid lane. We got the Starfall from S4, early level 2. Arrow's still available, going to fly it out. Storm Spirit brought down. Alliance will spill first blood. For all the harassment the Bounty Hunter was offering, it just took a good combination from EGM and S4 to bring down the Storm.
Early level Stomp was really hard to dodge, especially when you do not have boots yet on the Storm Spirit. But it was really important that he picked a level
3-4-3. He gets the courier. Dyer's had a decent amount on it too. It was the boots and the bottle of S4. Be a little bit annoyed about that.
They were very careful about making it fly over the tree line earlier. And maybe you should have suspected it because no one showed up to help out the Storm Spirit in the
early first blood. S4, you should be really careful. You're walking in range of a sentry ward. There's no vortex available from mid one. Couple of chips into the Mirana.
Out of my way!
I wonder if S4 is just gonna have to hook it home and let Elder Titan take experience. Like, there's no way you can see him even though.
Oh,
that's EGM
can
get a perfect. Ah, oh, there's no mana on S4. And 343 is coming in. The Shuriken Toss! Not enough damage. The Fairy Fire keeping S4 alive. Are really trying to push the issue against mid one and almost lost their mid-core alliance.
Alliance are in a really good spot now. Now that bottom lane, that sentry is gone, so now they can use that pool. Pull it up, pick up a Falling Blade too. You can even jungle pretty early on if he picks up a mask, but now they've gotten XP under two supports, one by pulling, one by getting first blood. The bottle's a setback, but as long as someone's getting XP in mid, it looks like EGM will be taking it, then they're okay.
Waiting for the stacks to arrive for Fnatic. Like, you're running as Ven, and right now I'm only seeing, like, one stack inside the Dire Jungle. There's nothing stacked on the Ancients. You could be a little bit concerned that Admiral Baldor could just slip over and try and take it. Ohio, he's... should be okay into the tree lines. RK, nice crush from Ohio. Just keeps RK away.
Back to the stacks.
Yeah,
it would help them out a lot if the Bounty Hunter were able to stack a little bit, but I think they're looking to press more in the lanes. Like, if they lose their T1, that might be a really good potential for Alliance to smoke gank there. They did it yesterday versus EHOME in this exact same situation where Fnatic were on Dire with the Sven, so they don't have that high ground ward, so maybe not too comfortable as to when the perfect time is, but their supports have been preoccupied, more than preoccupied.
Jay with nice zoning out of the top room, allows mid one to pick up double damage, so Storm Spirit with kill potential, Admiral Baldog, DJ can disrupt, goes for the catcher as well, and mid one, he wants to jump forward if he wants to go for Baldog, no level 6 on Tidehunter, so there is no Ravage available, it won't matter the poison, it is going to be enough, there's only one stack in it, but it will be DJ, bringing down Admiral Baldog. There was only one stack, but it was 3 levels in the Shadow Poison.
Wow, it's level 5 already. Mid one didn't even have to expend all his mana over there. He didn't really have to go in that deep. Nice stomp coming out from EGM to try and save his ally.
Radiant's top tower is under attack.
Pretty good. They're doing well.
Any phase looking good for them. He's still getting some Radiant good levels and farm onto Alliance. Like Loda has managed to crack the level 6. You can see him going for that early Dragon Lance. He's in really good range to beat down some of these towers, and that's required for Alliance. If Alliance is going to group up as 5, he's someone with a range to actually force a reaction out from Fnatic, and the best way to do that, start taking away the buildings.
Start taking down the wards. 343 just dewarded the mid Observer Ward on Alliance, and now they're flying blind. No Observer Ward out on the map right now, and they'll need some time for their lineup.
Push the lane to the tower. Loda triggers his aura. You really want this T1 tower down the bottom, and Ohio's in no position to fight. So this is a very easy, simple T1 tower for Alliance. It's to be expected when you run a Dura Ranger lineup with just an offlane slaughter.
And HOD creep already coming out. See the small Satyr Banisher, pull the Ancient Black Dragon, but T1's at critical HP, so this is no longer that safe a place for her.
Is this when 343 actually has like defensive ward, like on the cliffside next to Roshan?
Even so, you still have a hard time defending. Like, most teams will smoke up there, so the Observer War only offers you so much protection. You need some heroes out there to scout out the wall.
Mid one, he jumps in, actually takes the regeneration rune from under the noses of S4 and Bulldog.
Really important runes for Storm. He needs the haste, he needs the DD, the regen, like all these are really good. Illusion, bounty, fairly useless to him.
S4 also wants just the bottle charges. Can't get that. There's still a rune down on bottom lane. But they'll see RK making a play for it. But while that's happening, Ohio sprinting forward. 343 is going to get close in on Loda. So if he wants to slow him down, he can do so. Ohio's going to get scouted out.
I like the early lane build. They probably feel like, man, this guy's 1100 HP. How do we kill him? Especially without him. 343 looks like
the damage with the Storm. EGM brings it in. Ohio! He tried to stop him, but now in comes the Storm Spirit. Regeneration rune active. The Shallow Grave will keep EGM alive. And Agoni losing two, but in comes Storm once again. But he doesn't have the regeneration rune. There's no mana left. Only 8 1 charges and a couple of bottle charges. That's not instant mana. GM will TP out safely. And a good little skirmish attack there for Alliance.
And probably the two heroes that you least want to lose at this point, like Storm
a pretty big deal, but you need these two heroes to get level 6. They're severely lagging on damage, and how are they going to get bounty hunter kills and track kills without anything of the sort? And we already see a smoke come over the Ancients. I see two odds on him. Where is he going to base them?
One to watch the Ancients. And the rest of the maneuver is to look towards that mid tier 1. But while that happens, Mushi takes out the tier 1 tower on top lane. 3-4-3 starts to actually sits right on top of the Radiant Observer Ward. So Alliance are well aware he's there, and okay, 3-4-3. Just wondering if they could see him too. He wards the Ops, but it's an easy tier 1 tower. Middle tower
has fallen. This stack is going to be a hold. Very hard to hold, and
he's still stacking it.
Yeah, Alliance can easily do it with the Tidehunter. Dire's middle tower is he doesn't have a level 4 Anchor Smash, so it won't be that fast, but they can still do it.
Panic's coming down. They want to take care of this stack if possible.
You got the 4 levels up in Cleave for Mushi, so he's ready to go down and do it. If you want to fight into Ravage though, Alliance can easily swing over after the Bulldog, but Fnatic are going to have to commit multiple heroes to take down the stacks. No Echo Saber on Sven. It's not going to be fast at all.
Right now, Alliance is going to force him to fight the Ravage men or what? Like, they're just walking down the lanes, attacking a tower. Either Fnatic keep trying to side lane push, but that's only going to work for so long. Can they last long enough to get that Orchid onto the Storm Spirit? To get sure. Whatever, like, is the Blink Dagger for Mushi next?
They need the track though. 343 just used a Tome, but he's 30 XP shy of Essex. Leeching some from Sanctions.
That'll help.
There they go with Mushi and
Alliance.
Nowhere in sight to defend this. With that Obs Ward dewarded by 343.
Mushi, you're really, really low, man. He should be able to survive through the Black Dragons, but only barely. Calculated. We'll now have enough money to buy that Blink Dagger, if that is his wish.
Oda probably senses out that they're ganking him and doesn't even want to be to the left side. That is the most common gank spot.
Alliance are coming over. They're 4-man smoke maneuvering. Storm Spirit puts down the Remnants just because Loda came in close.
But he's in full defensive mode. Strength Treads and Dragon Lance. It's going to take him a while to kill him. Buying more time for that Grave to come out from Manta.
There are jump time. Well, Ohio already using his Crush to farm. And then sprints away. Alliance too far out. Obviously no Blink Dagger on that Tidehunter just yet. It's more of a mech build. Coming in, the survivability, the 5-man maneuver Alliance lineup. And Fnatic have dodged them. The smoke maneuver from Alliance will probably still end in the tier 2 tower and the bot lane dropping. But Mushi, straight back to the farm. They wait for the right time to fight.
He's back to farming, but he's also picked bottom up item. Sven's actually gone forward to the Blink Dagger. Normally at this juncture we see Echo Saber Armlet, so with the Blink Dagger pickup, he definitely wants to fight. They need to be able to kill Dazzle.
He's on TP though, he just TP'd up to the top lane. So this fight can only be held back by Shadow Poison, pretty much. That's their only level of, that's their only deep push. The mid one, he's actually Dyer's wrapping around the Rhea. Bombing up the camps right next to Alliance's push. The Slaughter is forcing the mid lane by crushing and Radiant's pushing to the tier 1.
They really need more tower damage in their other lanes. Mushi and Ohio haven't really been hitting the tower. Mushi's actually farming up the Radiant Ancients. In the meantime,
tier 2 tower is gone. DJ slept up by the stomp. And while he does have a defensive destruction, it won't come down in time. This fall with an easy style fall finds the pick.
They don't even get the mid T1 tower. Mushi was just... Oh.
Even in death, Shadow Demon can still cause a problem. I still love him mid-one, he's just waiting. Arcane will walk around the corner here. Oh, hi in the neighborhood. Arcane's gonna get picked. Alliance not moving out of the squad. They didn't really think anyone was behind, even though mid-one was creep-skipping previously. But even though they didn't take down the mid-tier 1 tower, Sven is still by far the top net worth on the field. Mid-1 is getting a lot Radiant's of farm from jungle camps. And now they have to Moonlight Shadow to protect Admiral Bulldog underneath his own tier 1 tower.
I think they're overcompensating for yesterday. Yesterday they didn't group up, they split up and farm too much and they got picked off. And this game, they look at Fnatic lineup, they look at their mistakes from yesterday, like, okay, we need to group up, we need to push, but they're not Radiant's really balancing out the farm and pushing that much. They're behind the network by a fair margin, despite there only being 7 kills in this game. And normally you'd be like, oh, well, Bounty Hunter's not really getting value out of it, but the other heroes are getting a ton of it, mostly to spend, and he is still ready to fight.
It's the XP crop, man, that's the bigger one. Like, a 6.5 grand going the way of Fnatic for that. Mushi right now, the Blink Dagger is a great fighting item, but it also is just making him progress from camp to camp inside the jungle.
I think they need to make them keep guessing where the Tidehunter is. As long as Tidehunter is showing, they know when and where to fight. Like, they I think they show the Drow Ranger pushing out the lane, and then is Tidehunter behind them? They don't know. Sometimes they have to let the Drow just solo farm. Sometimes they might have to overcommit and get baited out. They need to put them in that position. Ravage double down on bottom.
Yeah, bottom lane. They're going in. Ohio got it back. So they'll find the kill in the slaughter. Mid one is already ball lighting himself away. He's going to keep all the way back home. So you commit your Ravage. You bring down the slaughter. And you bring a lot of players down the bottom lane. But again, Fnatic pushing in the top lane. They're dodging Alliance every turn. S4 needs it, its arrow. DJ sidesteps it out. EGM with no spirit does have his storm pump. The DJ turns, purges. There's no one really attacking EGM apart from all the illusions of himself. And DJ even dodges the attack. The poison not enough to get the kill on the other Titan. All up on top, Mushi trying to just finish off this tower. The anchor smash causing some problems, but Mushi's still able to complete the job. And that's a tier 2 tower going the way of Fnatic.
Alliance are just losing structures. Then right, too many in the way of Fnatic at this moment. And it doesn't really matter if Alliance have boarded up the Dire Ancients, because Mushi can just farm up the Radiant.
He really doesn't care that much, does he? As long as he can find the money. And it's Alliance 5-man ball just being denied, pretty much.
He looks like an alchemist on the org chart. How far ahead he is of everyone else.
Difficult, like, for all the farming that Mushi's done, like, he's been 0 kills, 0 deaths, 0 assists, involved in absolutely nothing. Obviously, Fnatic's only got 3 kills in this 16-minute game so far, but then he builds an SMY, another early combat item. But once that's up, the Orchid should also be pretty much near completion for mid 1.
I like the Orchid rush this game, as opposed to the Bloodstone. Most of the Storms will get Bloodstone first, but I think with this sort of game, you need to control the Dazzle to fight so that the Drow it's also pretty good for the Tidehunter if you can actually coordinate and make sure that you focus them. But again, Alliance are grouping up. There's so many heroes in the top lane in Fnatic. We're like, okay, well, we'll just do Roshan. We have Amplified Damage. They have to respect the Storm Seal, one of the best Aegis carriers in the game, and the Alliance just gonna have to hand it over.
Yep, it's the oldest classic trade in the book. Roshan for a dire tier 1 tower. There's S4, well, he's coming over, throws the arrow, is gonna come into the pit. Roshan's low, and it is killed by the Dire. The arrow will connect on Mushi.
That was way too close. I think one of the heroes is like, okay, I'm just gonna tank it. They saw it coming.
Jump in front of Roshan. Yeah, well, S4 threw it out right next to a Fnatic hero. So now Fnatic, his Storm Spirit Aegis is immortal. Got a free jump in initiation with a second life.
Yeah, it's like, normally you want Bloodstone so you don't die in the fights and that area of HP, and if you survive you get Bloodstone charges, but with the Aegis they can just suicide for the Dazzle and I think just easily mop them up for a 4-on-1 or 5-on-1 trade.
So does Alliance just get involved now? Is that the play? Wait out the Aegis Immortal, or can they still 5-man maneuver? The Ravage is back up. They do have the mech on Bulldog.
They have the mech.
Are they stronger?
The more important thing, I think, is the Ags on the Murana that just came online. So with this, I think this is their timing. I think their line was built to fight. They can farm, but as I believe Winter mentioned earlier, it's like Bulldog's he's on Tidehunter this game. Not on a Lone Druid, he's not on a Bristleback, he's not on something that scales particularly well. He's 1-1-1, and they've been looking to fight all game, but keeps going at this rate. Fnatic's going to easily outscale them. They're just going to be able to mow them down with this overfarmed Sven, who can just get a BKB and just run at you. when he has that amount of mark, there's nothing that you can do. He's going to have like 30-plus armor, going to be affected by Ravage.
So instead they just have to group up and go.
They have to.
Well, 4-3, the dust will come out from EGM, finding him, trying to go straight to the stomp. That will put the Bounty Hunter to sleep, and a follow-up cold arrow. Elder Titan will find the last punch. So no Bounty Hunter for the fight, they won't have track available.
Bounty Hunter, or sorry, Spence already on the bottom lane, pushing, blinking past waves. Theory took down the T1, and only now do they start getting the T2.
Just a little bit to the south, Ohio waiting in the tree line, right next to S4 as well as Admiral Bulldog.
He's waiting for someone. He Mushi pop Godspeed. They want Alliance to TP out.
That's not happening yet. Okay, now it is. The Dazzle on the hillside is Arcade, who's the first one to leave. S4's on the run. Already stacked up with two poisons. The crush onto Admiral Bulldog. Mid one coming in close. Orchid is available for him. The ET split up. Fnatic easily dodging it.
And free T2 tower from Mushi. Just put Alliance in a really hard spot there. If they TP out with like a Tidehunter, they're they're just gonna jump them without Ravage. And if they don't TP back strong enough, then Mushi just takes the free tower and likely even gets the kill if it's a weak support. So they're just forcing Alliance into these inopportune trades and situations they constantly have to decide. DJ's like using a Tidehunter in check, so they can't back out cleanly. And now even Ohio and Bushi might even sweep in from behind if they're not careful. And Alliance can't even team fight at this point.
They have to back up. That's a huge creep wave up on top. There's the threatening Bushi on bottom. Fnatic is just playing like really smart and very elusive Dota against Alliance.
On top of that, looks like Mushi is finally going to go for a PKB. I say finally,
off playing the jump in. It was already set up with 3-4-3 coming in close. Gets the initial slow from Janata. Now with no Dro Ranger, Pin takes out another tower. 20 minutes in, farming up Radiant Ancients. There's only one remaining outer tower 20 minutes in for Alliance. And they're the team with the Dro Ranger. They're the team with a lineup that was meant to five-man force Fnatic into bad team fights. And that just hasn't worked.
This is going to be really bad. Sven, just 1 minute, he's going to have his PKB, and then they can just jump them without really any fear in the world. Or just wait until the next road, or they can split push and farm. Like, there's so many different options available for Fnatic right now. And the Alliance are...
They have one key item at arrive. They have a Blink Dagger on the Ravage, so technically now Abra Bulldog will be a lot harder for DJ to keep in check. They need Vision of Bulldog, however. Right now they got track over on Arke. They do see him quite easily.
Do they want to fight right now, though? There's still about half a minute left.
Fnatic knows. Like, you finish the BKB. Like, you don't go high ground without your BKB.
Well, and you have way better wards on the Fnatic side right now. Really deep birds. Whereas Alliance, they have one near the top, one kind of in the middle. Maybe not likely to get dewarded, but I don't really think they can do that much with that information. On top of that, Fnatic have the Bounty Hunter constantly scouting out for them.
At least know when Fnatic fall back over the river.
They want to time a fight with the Aegis Expiration. It's going to be about 5 seconds away. So now Alliance have the green light. Jump in.
But where's your target? The Observable scouts out Ohio moving north, but EGM is the only one near him.
So I think they have to do something before this. A really important time for them, but yeah, I think Fnatic are more than willing to take a fight. Up until then, they're like, okay, well, they're stronger than us right now. They have the Drow, but I think Drow is already kind of peaking relative to the Sven, when Sven is like 50%.
Speaking of which, Stone Spirit looks like he's... Okay, if Loda stayed there just a little bit longer, he probably would have just gone for the straight jump. Loda does have the Hopcane Pike up now. So he's got some extra things to work with from Alliance's high ground defense, and this isn't an unusual position for Alliance, being a long way behind. Fully 8,500 in the net worth, over 10,000 experience behind two. A very slow game, but a very patient game. You just have to pick the right opportunity.
Be really worried for the throwing. So.
Oh, Bulldog? Hello? We really meant to blink into Fnatic just then.
I think your worst nightmare going, like, as a Drow Ranger going to late game is like a super high armor hero going into you. We've seen TNC constantly draft the Axe versus the Drow Ranger, and Sven is a similar hero in that he just has tons of physical mitigation and will just run at you, disable the marksmanship, and just cleave you down. And you Radiant's just don't have that much upside as a Drow Ranger. And later in later game, guess there's not really that many items that can help you out.
3-4-3. Arrow's gonna be off target. You still got mid one in the neighborhood. They want to commit for this, it would take a lot from Alliance. Like, we're talking Ravage to even get a kill here. 3-4-3, oh, the double Darfall. You have to respect that magical burst damage that comes from the Morana Axe.
I think it might be worth it for Alliance to invest in a gem at this time, so they can actually take fights with the Ravage and maybe catch Fnatic off guard. One point, also just be worth
GM, we're dead. So dead. Mid one of Mushi. Just destroyed him on the bottom lane. Has fall, jump forward, then Mushi triggers the BKB. No Leaper Vest 4 thanks to the Orchid, and Mushi would just TP out under the protection of that magic community.
Work with 10 second BKB. Kill, half damage on the T3, and real 4 TPs that look like coming out from Alliance, and now they're kind of cornered in their base. Supports can't defend against these waves, they can't push out the lanes. That means you need a course to do so, which means you can really push out and take objectives, and I think they'll just constantly instill that fear onto Alliance. They have to huddle around their base, Roach is open to them, and then they have to be even more scared because Storm appears.
Oh, S4 actually managed to hit an arrow on Ohio, a good 5-second stun. He was just farming, but he was farming underneath the Radiant Observer Ward of Alliance. And it's pickoffs like this which will give Alliance some breathing room, and good time to have it. Roshan could potentially be up, but I can't just slip over. It's a 40-second respawn, so Slaughter will be up in time, but Alliance are already smoking up themselves. They move out, there's a sentry ward down, the bounty is not in range of this, they have no idea what's going on.
Bounty hunter scouted out. Pop, Tidehunter smoke.
Oh, they trigger dust. They know he's in a free line. The weave will give the vision, so 3-4-3. Out of Titan. Once again, EGM will find the kill. That's his third for the game.
That is the worst target for the smoking to pop on, though. And he even got an observer ward, so he can see, he has two observer wards down to the left side, so they can see exactly where they go.
Take anything at this point of the game though, and you're still getting a lot of money into Mirana as well as Dro. Fact that S4 almost has the same net worth as the Storm Spirit, pretty impressive considering the state of the game.
So we picked up a Yules. That's pretty good versus the Storm Spirit. You'll see Yules on two mid laners, I suppose, like Lina in particular, sometimes SF. What do you want to deal with the Storm Spirit back when they were really popular Alliance? Blowing a second smoke at this moment, they have the Ravage, and then they have all five heroes. This could be the time to brawl, but Mushi is the one to watch.
The Moonlight Shadow, 3-4-3 is going to break the smoke, the Moonlight Shadow still keeps them invis, not sure if Fnatic really saw it or not.
They're going to try and blow up Mushi? I don't know if they have enough damage to do it before he BKB.
Especially when S4's not there and Mushi just blinks into the tree line. That's the TP scroll available, hasn't used it yet. The Spirit searching for Mushi in the trees, but it's so close but so far away. Mushi's TP all the way home, while Fnatic actually four man smoke. The smoke will be broken by S4. Zip zap. Who gets tracked.
TP was a little bit too far back. I think I would prefer like a TP back to the T3 so they can re-engage very quickly, but now Fnatic can waste a smoke of their own, trying to catch Alliance and flank them from behind.
So hard for Alliance to really catch up to anyone from Fnatic. They got so much money, even DJ having this blink dagger. There's too much maneuverability on Fnatic. They got three blink daggers to work with. Then the invis as well. And the ball lightning.
Rana's farm though, I think she can easily get a pickup by herself with the Yules. Maybe not on the Sven, but anyone else I think is quite vulnerable.
Lotto's gonna be a lot happier too once he gets that ultimate orb. Having the mana style, breaking free of the Orchid silence of the Storm Spirit.
Spell amp.
Yep.
All pretty good.
Bulbog currently killing a traitor inside the pit, but he'll have to move over. Mushi hit by an arrow. Yule Scepter up. That's S4. Trying to prepare for another jump. They go for Mushi. BKB triggered. Ball lightning mid one. Trying to come in to help out his ball with a stun. Mushi walking away. The Ravage committed mid one. The damage from Lona. Suicide will happen. The Alliance don't get the kill, but at least they put the Storm Spear on the sidelines. EJ's not out of the woods just yet. S4 rotating over, gonna find 3-4-3. The first starfall into the second one. They've lost the vision on 3-4-3. And with a blink dagger, TJ got far enough into the mid lane trees to TP himself away to safety. So we can Alliance robbed of any kills thanks to the Bloodstone deny. But what are you thinking about Roshan?
They don't have Ravage for this.
Yeah, that was pretty good for them.
They had gotten Mushi there. Ooh. Highest net worth hero in the game, but not really able to contribute too much to the team. Not respect the magical burst from Piranha. Almost caught off guard. Feeling high and vulnerable with the BKB.
Fnatic are coming.
I think they can just go inside the road pit. How are they going to deal with the Elder Titan Spirit though?
Did EGM notice that? Yeah, he did. The Spirit actually clipped Mushi while it's still under the cover of smoke.
But you still have to fight without Ravage if you want to take a fight here. Ideally, you want to stall with the Elder Titan stun, but he just used it. There is no Spirit there.
Now that arrow actually helping Fnatic. A full 5-second stun on Roshan with the amplification. Alliance. Now they're going to Moonlight Shadow over the 3-Ravage! Ohio! Tinker straight into the mix! Fushi will try and credit. He only finds Illusion. Thornburn in pretty deep, but he'll find his target. And evolving EGM, pulling back the other side, decreasing by a little bit more life. Big one, the Aegis Immortal will trigger. EGM trying to hold his position. The ET split up. Well, Fnatic just waited all out. And then EGM will fall. They look for more. The stun on Arcane. The extra track will go to work. Fushi doesn't hit by Aris. We can't help out. The big one, the long jump in. Yulsever up with a gust. And keeps mid one control of the tier 2. Bota will get a revenge kill, and that's a big one to take a dominating streak ended.
See some excellent gusts from Drow Rangers recently. Nice one there to get the kill on mid one. That one will not be Bloodstone denied, so a lot of holds going the way of Alliance, and that was pretty good considering they didn't have Ravagers that entire fight. They did a really good job of limiting Stormbreaker's damage during that. Also, Sven, he didn't have protection. He went on the Illusions because that was the only thing that he could see, and he kind of got kited during his entire BKB duration. Now it's slowly starting to tick down. It's already 7 seconds down for Fushi.
Don't have this timer running out too early, but he is starting to rack up more damage as the Daedalus recipe, but doesn't have the Demon Edge at the moment.
The prize is mine!
We're gonna get to a point where Alliance, if they do get caught out by this Venom, it's only gonna take one swing and Fushi's gonna kill them all. That's just because he's got so much money, so much net worth, almost 19,000 on Fushi.
Looks like he's going Daedalus even, so it doesn't even want to tank up, I think. Like, I kind of like Fear's build yesterday where he went for like Blink HOD AC and BKB pop. Well, depends on what kind of a defensive support that you have. But I think the AC is like really, really good for the lineup. You're going to be kited because there's Grave, there's like Yules, and all these other spells. BKB's duration is getting kind of low, so you can still help your team out with the Aura. You don't know how many swings you're going to get off. And he also doesn't have an Echo Saver, which I think is really where the build shines.
That's the thing Alliance had just done. They planted an Observer Ward and Sentry Ward at the top river. This will allow them to know when Fnatic is coming to gank S4, who with BT and that high movement speed, thanks to Yule Scepter and the maneuverability of Blink Dagger, he can just keep that split push going on top. Problem is, he hasn't seen any of Fnatic in a while, so he's very concerned they're just waiting somewhere.
Now, as you mentioned earlier, Alliance have kind of used to being in this vision where they're down but not out, and gonna have to rely on normal tactics to do this late game. And good T on Marana, good way to start split pushing. Draw Ranger, not the best at split pushing. It's not a Terrorblade, it's not anti-mage, it's, you know, not a Naga Siren. Bota probably would have favored at this point in the game, but he stuck with what he has. And
Lions? Four-man smoke move, they're gonna come up through the river.
They have BKB on Ohio.
Their Observer Warden Sentry is gonna scan out 343 in a bit, but oh, the Moonlight Shadow, the smoke broke as well. The Bounty Hunter scouts out what's going on, and Fnatic, they're getting out of here. They do not want to give Alliance a fight again. And at least Alliance with the lane positioning where it is, and Ravage up, it can do what they were meant to do all along. Five-man maneuver, push to a tier 2.
A BKB ready for two of them. Elder Titan Spirit comes out and is going to hit on the smoke heroes.
Dyer's and again, Bulldog, Anchor Smash, 3-4-3. It was the Rage, it's the Sentry Ward, they're stopped there for the jump forward. Bota, that's gonna snap back all of Fnatic. Looking all on the Throat Ranger, the damage is spent just way too much. The Ravager by a little bit of space here. Also helps him to get the kill over on that Storm Spirit. Arcane, TP's out, not possible. Mushi has the stun available. Even Ohio crushing for good measure.
Oh my god, that Drow Ranger just got obliterated. She had amplified damage and got hit by a split hurt, and there was no time to grave, no time to really do anything there. Tidehunter maybe could have ravaged, but that's not going to help versus the BKBs. The tough fight for Alliance. They, at least they didn't have a gem there. That would have been really disastrous. Fnatic recently picked one up on DJ at that point, but Alliance is not geared for 5-on-5 at this point.
Also a bad sign when Fnatic, it could be willing to push even harder. This should be the tier 2 tower at least down the mid lane, because there's no Ravage for 97 seconds. Every time this thing is off cooldown, Fnatic will be more and more confident to fight, even with the BKBs already up. They already feel confident enough when the Ravage is there.
They need a way to pop the BKBs without being ravaged. Because Fnatic, they're not really scared. The one time that we did see the BKB cores scared was when Mushi got jumped on the bottom side. And I think they need to do that again. I think the Marana may need to go for a very burst heavy build. Like an EB, you just like leap in, you use your EB,
double Starfall combo and then you can disengage. I think we saw that from like Old Chicken. But you want them to like, oh crap, I have a BKB right now or I'm gonna die. They do have like Defensive Disruption, but you always want to make them panic, and then once the BKBs are down, Ravage. And right now it seems like Fnatic are actually forcing the Ravages out of the Tidehunter instead, so that it's an easy for the team fights.
That's been the way this whole game's been going, is Fnatic forcing any reaction they want out of Alliance, and always denying Alliance what they want. Big group up and team fight, at least with a vision advantage. The fact that Bounty, he can sacrifice himself all he wants. 3-4-3, he hasn't got a single kill, he's got 7 assists, he's all about getting the track up, 4 deaths to his name, but he's that walking reveal ward that Alliance just can't do anything about. Wouldn't have been happy too, the fact that EGM with that smoke break on him, or the Moonlight Shadow break on him.
Way it did.
But they're coming again. Alliance will group up.
This time, Fnatic have another BKB, this time on the Storm Spirit, so this fight could potentially even go worse than last time.
Unless they can find the jump. But with a Dire Sentry Ward on the hill, Alliance can't get really good vision here. That's why they put their Observer and Sentry up in the lane and a little bit further down, more shallower in Fnatic's jungle. But they can't find the opening, there's no real way they can go, so they fall back. Loden needs to bounce his BKB as well, he's about 1,000 gold away from that. They give him the bottom lane to do so.
I think even with the BKB, he's just gonna, like, what's the BKB gonna do versus Sven? Sven will just right-click you, and even if you force tap away, you can still get cleaved if someone's out in front, or if you have Manta Illusions, which will actually likely happen in a team fight. Fnatic trying to smoke the long way around. Roshan not available to them for at least.
They're coming for Loda. Loda is right on top of that Dire Observer Ward, plus he's farming the creep wave. That is one very, very dead bro. With a blink crush, mid one goes in. And that is a full limit on the sidelines because he bought his open club before he died. The arrow will keep Mushi away, perfectly hit from S4. And now it's up to Alliance to keep Fnatic out. They have 1 minute without Loda.
Well, half of Godstrain's duration at least has been gone for them, and Loda did manage to buy an Ogre Club. That means he won't have buyback if they're gonna have to hold this.
Mushi keeps going. The arrow, this is once again playing crush. S4 caught out. He doesn't have his sleep available. He doesn't have his ultimate, however. Send him up and towards the end. He's still keeping Ohio out of the fight. He hits the ground from the Yule's, a quick blink out. Fortification is still available for Alliance and Fnatic.
Dire's middle tower.
Not gonna go for any more. The BKB is on cooldown for the Storm Spirit. Mushi is gonna force the input.
They just wanna be able to play safe, take down the Roche, give the cheese to Storm. If he has Aegis cheese, he can just go absolutely crazy in this fight. Yeah, 2.5 minute respawn. So a little bit of time for Alliance to find out how they wanna defend the pit, maybe deward their side of the jungle.
Is it now that time for the vision? That time for the vision?
I think they needed it a while ago, but the problem is no one's really getting any farm. Elder Titan went for the solo crest to try and help protect the Drow Ranger. Dazzle has just been buying wards non-stop. It would have to be like Murano or something like that. Would buy the gem, maybe Tidehunter. Tidehunter is 1100, so I think it's that time. You're getting close to that point where one more fight and you're gonna go into that like point of no return.
At the same time, like, you know what's in Bulldog's mind. This is the way Bulldog plays. He's thinking, I need a refresher orb. If I have my double Ravage, those BKBs go down to 5 seconds, I got a chance that team fights can actually go the way of Alliance with that big AoE double stun time. And then the control, S4 spends his money,
Radiant's
he buys a Shiva's Guard from this
attack.
Mirana. Into three melees. Helps try at least keep him away from this Ven once that BKB wears off.
They need some way to deal with the BKBs. Instead of going for offense, he will go for the defense.
Just survive. Try and fight another day. Urshan's up in 1 minute.
Lions are huddling their base though. They've blown a lot of smokes in the last 10 minutes, so I don't think they have another one available to them. It doesn't look like they have any in stock. I don't see any on chicken, none of the stash. So I don't know how they're gonna try and take this next fight. What's the best angle of approach for them?
But you do still have Moonlight Shadow. But then there's all 10 sentries down for Fnatic inside the Radiant jungle. That also helps. Keep getting their lanes pushed in. Fnatic goes back to what they start this game with. They
Just keep pushing in the top, they keep pushing in the bottom.
Oh, and they got COT so on his own
creep.
Oh, Roche.
Radiant's top tower is under attack.
There's an Aghanim Scepter on the Shadow Demon now.
Wow. Yeah, we thought the SD had a decent amount of farm before. Full Ags, Ohio. King is lips at just the side of Loader on the bot lane.
How's he almost as farmed as Bulldog?
Good question.
Radiant's
he has been the deep push for Fnatic early on. I know his high level's up in poison, he was mopping up the creep waves all the time.
Okay, Roshan respawned. Seder Banisher will get wind of it. Fnatic can start thinking about making their way there after they push up. Of course.
Our Alliance?
Radiant's
okay.
Middle tower
well,
S4 attack.
Gets rid of that setup.
They can really easily scout with Illusions though, or Storm Spirit, so I don't really think Fnatic are that worried about them sneaking it. They can try.
Alliance are in there, and right now Fnatic have made no movement over. This one is in the neighborhood. Okay, now they're making a better movement. Roshan down a half life, even starting to kick up. For Alliance, they got a lot of armor to work with. N4's already dropped the Aquila in preparation. The EC split up. Mid one if you want to jump in. The split too early. Ohio gets the crush. Get killed by the Silent Dagger. He picked up the Agency Wall. Alliance tries something sneaky. Now they may pay the price for it. Mid one's all over him. The Shadow Brave will keep S4 alive a little bit longer. The mid one is there. Waiting arms. Will he even find him? No into the tree line. Piranha will TP out. Unfortunately for the rest of Alliance, they will not have that option. Loader as well as Bulldog drop. Bushi chases to the ends of the earth, Hake. And they move over to EGM, who's just trying to man fight against DJ. There is no way to fight to win that fight. Alliance getting crushed in the pit. Fnatic, they arrived late to the party. If that splitter was just a fraction of a second later as well, it could have been huge for him.
Yeah, it was almost perfectly timed by EGM, but Fnatic, three in the pit. Two BKBs and they got the Aegis kill, they got the Roche kill, they got the Aegis, and Bulldog was not able to get his Ravage off that fight. Not like it would have mattered too much because of the BKBs, and Mushi was just on top of Loader the entire fight.
No space for the drone, she'll buy back, fortification will slow down the Rakting, and oh, caught out by Storm Spirit, a perfect jump from mid one, it's a nice dust from Loader, maybe he can get a revenge on the 343, but DJ is dead. The waiting disruption arms. 4-3-4-3 out of the firing line. Fnatic will finish the job. They bring down the melee. And now Bulldog comes to the front line. There is that BKB over a mid one as well as the cheese. So all this damage can be repaired. And he'll use his BKB charge instead. And a 7 seconds on that one. And Alliance sort of clean up the bottom. Cost them then. The buyback on the drone. They did not want to have to do that.
Still very long time left on Piranha's respawn. And they, most of this game though, they just have not been able to fight effectively as 5. Like Fnatic aren't really worried about fighting into them because Alliance, they weren't able to push
double
hard
damage
in the early game. They weren't able to secure many objectives. They weren't able to control the Ancients that allowed Sven to propel himself to this same network.
Hello.
It's Alk Sven.
It's a refresher of Mushi. Ben will now have double 5-second BKBs and double God Strength. Depending on what he wants to drop, unless he gets his own dedicated courier.
The region's also very useful. They, like, near the end of the last fight, he had like 180 mana, which is just not enough to keep going. They don't really have many ways to... Is he gonna drop something? Maybe a little bit. What, he has Moonshard and Refresher?
Yep. Yeah, it's got a lot of money. She's actually going at just shy of 800 gold per minute.
Dang. You want him to like kind of be forced into these like questionable things. Like,
you really want to get MKVs, good versus Drow, not versus not good versus anyone else. So.
He'll get whatever he wants.
Yeah, he's not really worried.
The guy's a superstar. He's got all the money in the world.
He has his own personal armory.
Just use that standard blacksmith that everyone else uses.
Oh. Night and shop is for plebs.
Bottom lane, hello. Fnatic? They're looking for Alliance. Alliance aren't even in their base. They know it's not safe. And hang on, are they... Okay, DJ is attempting. He's attempting the moon play. They'll wait in the tree lines, but that one range creep, it'll come down, it reveals. It reveals Alliance.
Radiance bottom
I mean, it reveals Fnatic. They'll bring down the Marine Direct anyway, so Alliance, in a way they dodged the fight. But they have everybody up.
They were able to pop a sentry up and an observer ward down too, and it's not in the normal spot. It's much further south and it will dodge the normal sentry ward. They do have the gem on the ET, so they won't have three jumps inside of the base available to them.
That was the one advantage for AGM. He bought that gem just before the Roshan fight. So technically didn't lose that much money in a Roshan.
So Alliance have been in this position where they've been down a lot, but you know who's also been in this position is Mushi, where he just has, he's just like overflowing with gold. He's made of gold. He spits out gold then. What does he spend it on? He can't pull Axe. He can get BOT2s. It's marginal. He's already had to sell his treads, which is...
Maybe he could actually start buying wards for the supports. That would be a very nice thing.
That's what you do, wards.
Yep. So they found S4. Ohio with a perfect blink drop. S4. He doesn't have enough time to live. And now it's actually moving on to Bulldog. Amplification Ohio was thinking about it. 73 seconds. Got S4. He does have buyback available once again. Really, you don't want to be expending your money when you're already pretty well broke. Otis gonna spend his cash, picks up a Maelstrom. Probably praying he can reach an Aghanim Scepter sometime soon. But it's good defense. Now Bulldog jumps forward, nice guard, Mushi. Down a half line for defensive disruption again from DJ. Always there when he took that Blink Dagger, Mushi. Wow, she's still very, very low. Four staff him away. Maybe this is also one of the reasons why he doesn't drop that Helm of the Dominator. So needs that sustain in the fight.
Yeah, Satanic or Heart would be pretty good for him. You could just BOT back and then refresh and then BOT back if they really wanted to fight, but there's no need in taking that risk. Actually, Mirana's down. I don't think it'd be the worst in the world for them to do that, but...
It's a good display though to show that Fnatic isn't really as tanky as you might expect. When they get their jumps, when they get their pickoffs on Alliance, it works beautifully. But if Mushi takes that much damage from pretty much just the Dro Ranger primarily attacking him.
It normally won't happen like that though. The Slaughter is carrying a lot of auras. We recently touched the last, you have the PC, so combine that with Warcry and you're not really doing anything. You need the Mirana to deal damage.
But yeah, it is a little threatening in case Fnatic aren't really exact with their high ground push. Positioning has to be good. You can't just leave one guy on the front line to do all the work.
You can't just A-click and take your hands off the keyboard. Oh, Jimmy thinks. Have you seen him? He's like, look guys, no hands!
Imagine that. He would have been that kid on the bike. Bloodthorn up for mid one. So he's got a lot more solo pickup potential. He's right underneath an observer and sentry. Will not survive as DJ moves in with a gem. But Alliance at least get to see that Bloodthorn before the fight begins. That's some decent dispel. Don't have that dream like quick Lotus Orb available. It's coming from Tide. It's the refresher Tide on the way. Or just buys the Perseverance for now.
Still a long ways away.
This is Alliance, the team of patience. Still only down one lane of racks. They're fine with that. This lineup, if you can get Nagin Scepter as well, onto the Dro Ranger. You'll have a lot of options as far as... Nope, not gonna miss.
We're really lacking items on the supports though, especially Dazzle.
You'd want like a Ghost Scepter at the point.
Big Glimmer. The Axe. Point of the game.
And same with Elder Titan. He has Soul right now, but...
Any... pretty much any item would be great for him.
Concern when Bulldog moves down with his fire, but disrupted before. It's like he's trying to bait the attack from Fnatic. But still at least protect Loda. As well as S4 if he does get initiated on.
Yeah, maybe they can like force a lot of BKBs when they initiate on Tidehunter and then he can buy back TP back in with Ravage. That is a pretty good way for them to win a fight. Fnatic have to know that. Ganked a lot of gold. Roshan respawning in 30. Manic, no creep inside. Roshan pit this time. Probably sensing that it's like right
here. Oh, Bulldog, he jumps in with the same time move. He has the team three towers. People make the play for Arcane. He'll find the kill, no buyback available. Loader pushing back Mushi. He's in deep under the tier 4 towers. Maybe they'll have the damage. Mushi dropping quickly. He'll BKB, but they get the kill. 3-4-3. Also going to fall. It's the Storm Spirit who's already out. They've had more kills. Yulz it up. DJ trying to keep Alliance away with that perfect EGS stop. And Fnatic, they were so patient. They were waiting.
they lose three. And what a time too, because Roshan is back up again. Alliance can move over and technically force the buybacks as Ohio scouts out the fact that Big Man is alive.
Alliance 1, TI3 off the back of a lot of 4-staff plays, and that was a very similar situation. They doubled 4-staff the Drow Ranger, and Sven was like pretty close at a T4.
He almost kicked out at that rate.
Yeah.
S4 got over 2,000 gold just from the kill. He's now up to 6k on the Mirana.
Oh, they were going to play it safe.
I think that's actually the most amount of money I've seen so far in TI for a killing spree. It was 1,640 gold for killing off Mushi underneath that big tier 4.
That's ridiculous. He has 6.
Oh, Midline trying to go for this kill. Well, he's already found one. A 10. Poor Arke is just a scratching post of Fnatic.
Oh, that will not dissuade Alliance from taking down Big Bad Roshan. Solo Crest already upon him. The Hive is in a good position for a four-man crush if he wants it.
He knows they're in there. He comes the jump, the crush, the silence will be there. Admiral Bulldog, he's already expensed the ramage before, so you've lost one. Loda can't really fight it. The Hurricane Pike puts himself on the hillside, however. He can't get back down again, so he'll have to TP back to base. And then that one! Very close. That was a kill Alliance could not afford.
Dire's middle tower.
But yes, now they realize Fnatic will have Roshan.
Roshan has fallen.
And now back out, they think it's the advantage of stealing the gem off Fnatic.
Dire's middle tower has fallen.
Very small advantage at this point.
At least they didn't lose any cores. Tidehunter died in that big engagement inside the base and did have to buy back, so he won't have refresher for this upcoming engagement. And all they really need to do is wait for them to go on to Mushi. Mushi just needs to hit towers. If they go on him, he just pops Warcry. This curry up.
This is one perilous trip. The Observer Ward scattered out its movement. I'm fairly certain it's here for the point booster. Actually finishes a full E-Blade for Mirana. This courier has to get home.
Storm King. Easy.
Yeah.
Jump it.
And 343 is also waiting for it. He'll move. He'll blink. Oh, so close. Now the storm just hit the courier. 4.7k worth of net worth.
So much for that Sven kill.
Yep, you'll have to wait 3 minutes before he can get that E-Blade. That also means he does still have buyback, so it doesn't put that in any kind of peril. I was wondering if Loda was going to complete up the Agnum Scepter if you put a point booster on that courier as well. Instead, I'm seeing a Crystallis purchase on Loda. Still has buyback, doesn't have the full axe, which would have been really nice with the Maelstrom combo, but he's going a Daedalus build on this Drow Ranger.
He's just trying to get any sort of items he can before this last fight. This might be like the last fight of the game, and you want every little bit of net worth that you have outside of buyback to be invested onto your hero. And net worth graph is looking pretty bad, but Mushi is banking 8,500 gold.
Yeah. Have we even seen him use that refresh orb even once?
Nope.
It's sat in his stash. It's almost like he's just buying home bling.
Radiant's middle tower is under
attack. On the front line, getting dragged up. Mushi gonna God Strength hit the tower. Just walk right, hit the tower. Fortification will also be burnt from Alliance. They're being pressured on the other lane though. S4 needs to deal with his mid. The bottom lane is still with the Mega Creeps. Alliance have to turn their attention down there every now and then, but they don't want to turn away from this top fight. Ravage has just come up for Admiral Bulldog. They still have buyback available for Mirana as well as Frozen. The damage is there. Bulldog, great blink away. Yeah, that was enveloping enough. But Ravage for that Ohio might be low. Mid one, he's going in deep. Under the tier 4 talent. Moonlash has been very difficult for Fnatic to find a target. The Ravage! He'll blow! The BKB is to take them. Mid one will drop as well. So low, but not dead. Has the agency mortal. Now that trigger. Mushi gets fired up away with a barely arrow. Bulldog! He will smash him in twine with an anchor. He's the only to be protected. Alliance, they're holding this fight. Ohio is low. They fall top down. Loda pushes himself into the fight. He wants to go against mid one. S4 need to help him. They've got the damage. The Mirror's got the range. Jumping in closer. You're not for Mirana. Where does he go next? He goes in deeper. He goes for the Starfall. Mid one's still alive, but not much longer with a stun under S4. He'll die with the help of DJ. The double buybacks are available for Alliance. They knew this. They still have to hold the bottom tier 4 towers that are being attacked. The refresher orb is now off of Bulldog. He's already triggered it, and he leaves it at base. He doesn't reveal it. So maybe now Fnatic could go in thinking there is no Ravage available. And it looks like Fnatic, they've been cautious throughout the day. They're going to be cautious again.
then actually used his buyback during that fight and finally used it for pressure, BOT back in, but he doesn't have buyback. That's probably what dissuaded him more than anything. Stormtrooper was a little bit low, but he has plenty of Bloodstone charges. And he's also making a lot of gold. 6,000 in Storms and Glory. What will be item number 6?
For a Storm Spirit, I'd be excited. He can finally drop that gem. Yes, Scythe would be nice. Still want to see Loda finish up an item and finally see Mirana with that E-Blade. The Courier is back alive. You have to keep that in mind. Esco had all that money spent, but he didn't actually have the item on him. If there was an E-Blade in that fight, it would have been very, very different.
Esmond's dying very, very easily. I actually think he should keep the Refresher on him so he can BKB twice and Warcry, right?
But what do you drop? You really want to get away with the... Like, you can't
try.
Yeah, that'll be good.
He needs to play like a Lifestealer. Lifestealer, you siege your tower with your Rage Bull Knight. I think he needs to do the same thing with Warcry and then just back out. They're having to blow way too many cooldowns to save him. Like, DK almost got him out of his way. He got four-stepped out and then he disrupted and then he was able to blink after that and he almost got the BOT out. But you don't want your Sven to be in that position where you actually have to save him.
Hey, how does DJ have this much money? He's now going to BKB on the Shadow Demon.
Oh,
it's coming on the Courier. This is, like, if you've got DJ in your fantasy team at the moment, congratulations. You're going to have crap tons of points. Even though the highest points right now does go the way of Mushi.
So out of the 10 heroes in the game, there is only one with buyback. That is mid one.
Everyone else expends their money. They know they need to fight. Alliance are very counter to this. If they keep Fnatic out for another minute, they have double Ravage. The Refresher Orb is off cooldown in 57 seconds time.
I'm actually surprised Stormspeeder doesn't have more charges. I guess they haven't that many kills in this game, but ideally you have 25 charges, maybe 26, and then you...
He got the early charges, then had to commit suicide, then he got killed, and after that everything just dried up.
But, like, now Storm's in this, like, somewhat weird position in the fight, so if you die, you can be back up and see, like, 35, 40 seconds, but you want to fight there with him instantly. You can potentially win the game if you buy back, but you could also potentially lose the game if you buy back BOT and your team's already dead.
Well, not a great situation for him. We've hit this point now. It's disrupting Sven Illusions to attack a range Rax down.
Yurt of Secret lives on.
I think this is also something Alliance have a lot of experience with in the past.
They're normally the ones doing it.
Yes, they are. It's the same team. They don't actually have easy ways to get rid of these illusions. It takes so much. This is when you actually wish you had that Agnum Scepter on Loda.
Well, I'm gonna start on another tower that will...
Hey, is Alliance real? Now for a moment, actually, there was a Fnatic line being drawn by mid one saying, can we move around and go in through the mid?
The Refresher's cool down at this point, and Sven really squishy. If they can catch him in a double Ravage without his Warcry, and potentially, like, DJ doesn't BKB, maybe, but that's a lot of good digits.
Yeah, that's a lot of babies. And they also have no vision to do this fight with.
Radiance,
like, the Observers and Sentries on the top lane are very
they have the reward right here,
Fnatic.
Right outside their T3 on top. This one can potentially be a game-winning Observer ward if they can catch multiple heroes with that. And DJ, well, actually, who's carrying them? Stormfear hasn't really been close enough to deward that quite yet. They have a Sentry ward on the north side, but it's just outside of range of the Ops. So they probably think they're in the clear in terms of not having vision. But it's daytime, so you're likely to play more carefully during the daytime.
Yep.
You expect the opponent to be able to see across the cliff. Nighttime, I think, is where Alliance can make a move, but that's still quite some time.
It's still crazy to think that Alliance are keeping this bait. They're almost 40,000 net worth behind, and they are still keeping Fnatic out. Most of that net worth, in fact, the difference is Sven's net worth. He's at 40 grand himself.
Middle tower is under attack.
He has a lot of, like, marginal upgrades for items. Like, BOTs is like 4,500 gold that doesn't really give you any combat potency. And then he has a Refresher in base, not really offering that much to him. Moon Shard, not super effective. It's good, but not because of effectiveness for gold spent.
They really need more damage against those Sven Illusions. they just keep coming, and bit by bit, that melee ranks. At least it can regen, but... You have to commit double Starfall to it, it's still not enough damage. Loader doesn't have his full Daedalus up, so his damage also isn't that great.
Probably Rugeneth not getting axed now. Because he was in that position where like, okay, I might lose a game right now. I have 2,000 extra gold. I need to buy an item.
Can he go back for it? Like, do you actually sell the Crystallis and then buy the full Aghanims? Oh, bottom lane, they actually find Ohio the arrow. Vintage from Man 4, big one. He's got air. Again, Arcane.
You blew it.
The punching bag of Fnatic gets brought down again. They look for an opening. Well, okay, BKB's triggered. It's Mushi on the run. S4 right behind him. The Soul Bolt will go to work. There's mid one. Pokes the tier 3 tower in the mid. And again, Ohio on the bottom lane. Death by 1,000 needles. Lions just don't know how to start pulling them out.
At least Mushi's playing it a little safer. Like, he could have potentially gotten EV'd and Shiva's and, like, double Starfall before the BKB. And then he'd be at, like, half HP, have to... Up, but now he's like defending himself from getting all critical HP territory.
And Alliance have to add some and come out here and try and fight this.
Yeah.
Like, if this continues the way it is, like, Fnatic will eventually take everything. They've already taken the melee rags on the top. It's only the mid that stands between Fnatic and Mega Creeps.
How do you protect Ake though? Ake just dies.
There is no way to protect him. Like, you actually just have to let him die. Force the fight, but Fnatic just left a little bit more mid one. Now look towards Admiral Bulldog. He's still giving respect. Admiral Bulldog does have double Ravage up. Mushi, he's bad damage. Bulldog jumps in. The first Ravage will trigger. They need to kill off Mushi. Defending attack from DJ. Not doing the work. Punishing attack. The Hurricane Pike can't just sit one away for long enough. Where is the kill? Has it come? Refresh Rom is done by Tidehunter. Four starving back, getting him the poison. Almost killing Bulldog. Barely surviving with a refresher into a second Grieve. Bulldog keeps himself up. But now they don't have double Ravage for 180 seconds.
I feel like we should be doing so much more in these fights too.
Oh, Radiant's Curry died again.
2900.
It had Lotus beyond you. It got killed as it entered in through that top lane.
Bushi, like, needed to BKB the Ravage. And Shadow Demon was able to do it. Your supporter can BKB it. And luckily he was able to get the disruption onto
the Sven.
Oh, my 3-4-3 to stay alive. Him and Aegis Seymour if you want to. You're actually trying to decide who to take, so Big One.
Mine.
He'll be the man to take the Aegis of the Immortal. Also Bloodstone's enough, but it means that Gem's just in the deck. 3-4-3 will have to carry that.
They could just pass Storm Spirit the Jeez afterward. Still no Scythe on him, but he does plenty of damage, enough to kill Ake near instantaneously. Dazzle has afforded a Ghost Scepter though, so maybe they can kill the Storm Spirit as he jumps in. Because you don't want to use your BKB for a Dazzle kill, obviously. But they only have one Ravage left on Tidehunter. All won't be up for a couple of minutes.
I still can't believe Mushi is walking around with the SMY refresh roll in his stats. He's also a very long way away from the rest of his team. As mid one, just gonna cop a little bit of a Starfall damage.
Like, they could easily buy another chicken at this point.
Yeah.
Another gem. He just stash as much.
Okay, he's buying Butterfly. He's going down and buying Butterfly. So that's what he replaces his SMY with.
Butterfly's great. Also gives you some move speed if you still want that for whatever reason.
It's nice when Loader also cannot buy a Monkey King bar in this game.
That's why you hold a Demon Edge. You never know when it's going to be Rapier,
or MKG, or Daedalus.
I was playing.
Someone give Loader some true hit. Oh, they just... And then again, now it's actually helping. 10 more illusions in.
Oh yeah, the illusions with the...
Oh, big one! He gets jumped in! The jump's in! And the ball is going to get the trap! What a bad position for Bulldog! He just pulls no buyback! They have no Ravage Hero Alliance! This can be it for Fnatic! The buyback will come out from S4! But you lose two heroes, and I didn't really have to commit that heavily!
Oh my god, DJ with those demonic purges! Onto the Tidehunter, onto the Marana!
And now he goes over the Grow Ranger! Keep going to work, you got all the vision, thanks to Crack. And Storm Spirit, another long jump in, they find Loader. The Heatblade protecting it from S4, but Loader still so low. He can't Hurricane Pike out, the buyback will come in. But Alliance, they're being torn apart. There's almost nothing left. Fnatic, they have waited this game out. They have hoarded the money. And finally, they can bring down this melee rack. Forces to make it a double crush for Hire. That could feel the deal as Alliance will lose all three. And GG, game one will go the way of a very patient Fnatic.
this strategy seems like something that Alliance thought would work, but it doesn't really seem to... I don't know, it was just like a whole entire team. They could never really circle fights in the first 20 minutes of the game. I think that Mushi played pretty well for the first 20 minutes, and then the later half of the game was dominated by Mid1 and DJ.
3-4-3 also with some timely smoke pops.
3-4-3, like, he was, again, that kind of guy that takes it for the team. The bounty hunter does the work, but the SD, so much money on it. Like, normally you say, hey, you might be in, like, a 4-core lineup that was attacking you from Fnatic.